Stanberry, so it's just blessing you, I guess, today. I think Bill is going to come and share some announcements. Do you have a couple of announcements, Bill? Do you have any announcements to share? No? Well, I will just share this one. I think you've got the order form in your bulletin. Maybe if not, we can find you one. This is for the Easter lilies. When do we need to have this money in? Or do we need it a few weeks before Easter to get them ordered? So you got a few weeks if you want to do a lily. There's some order forms. We'll get you one if you don't have one. So,
and then as Bill pointed out. To?
Do what?
Who do we give the money to?
Give the money to Evanel.
Put it in the collection
plate. Put it in the collection plate and just mark it Easter Lily so we can keep track of that for them. Okay? And then Joyful Noise on Wednesday. I think that's it. Is that what you're thinking too, Bill? Sounds good to me.
Sounds good to me.
Let us begin our worship.
The one who calls us.
Let us join in our opening hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, number 110, are on the screen.
Oh,
a responsive reading this morning. This is Psalms 91, 9 through 16. Because you made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your habitation.
No evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent.
For God will give his angels charge over you to guard you in all your ways.
They will bear you up on their hands, lest you dash your foot against a stone.
You will tread on the lion and the adder,
the young lion and the serpent, you will trample underfoot.
Because they cleave to me in love, I will deliver them.
I will protect them because they know my name.
When they call me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them.
I will satisfy them with long life and show them my salvation.
Will you please stand for the glory of our church?
Greater than the songs we sing.
temptations. We believe. We believe.
We believe in God the Father.
We believe in Jesus Christ.
We believe in the Holy Spirit.
And He's given us new life.
We believe in the crucifixion.
We believe that He conquered death.
We believe
in the resurrection. And He's coming back again.
If the last we
found at the temple bridge,
He will have the blood of the wind.
People who remind us how great it is to believe. We thank you, Lord, for this day that we could gather together today in worship. We thank you for this Valentine's Day that we are reminded of love. We thank you for everyone in our lives who love us, our parents, our children, our spouses, our siblings, our friends, our extended family, our co-workers, whoever that is, Lord, we thank you for the people in our lives who love us. For not a one of us could get through this life without someone, without people who love us. And Lord, most of all, we thank you for your love. For you loved us so much that you gave us Jesus. And we thank you. Lord, we do have concerns on our hearts, and some we share and some we keep silent. We pray for Mrs. Pickering, and we pray for our baby who needs prayers, our young one who needs prayers. We lift up all of those who need your strength and courage. For any in our families or community who are fighting various cancers, we lift them to you. For those who had surgery this week and are rehabbing, we give thanks to you for them as well. And Lord, just remind us as we hear the scriptures today to keep our minds open and to truly listen and hear them talk to us, knowing that we all, each and every one of us, sin and fall short for the glory of God. Be with us all as we celebrate Valentine's Day. And help us all today, Lord, to call somebody, to email or text or however we communicate, to call somebody and just say, I love you on Valentine's Day, because you love us so much. Hear us now, O Lord, as we join together in the prayer that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven,
give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Does anyone have a God moment to share from this week?
Yeah, these two kids and their enthusiasm to light the candles.
It's nice we've got two to light the candle, so it doesn't have to be you. All right. Thank you, guys. It helps a lot to have you here to light the candles. Will our ushers please come forward and collect this morning's offering? The Wednesday of Holy Week. The class is entitled, or the book is The Last Words, The Final Words from the Cross is the name of the book. You're welcome to come. I said it'll be 6:30, probably 6:30, 7:30 for just these 6 weeks. The other thing I wanted to share is next Sunday evening in Albany at 5:30, if you would like to come to the church, we're going to watch the movie The War Room. Some of you might have seen it when it was in theaters. Some of you, I have not seen it, but I've heard it's an excellent movie, so I got it. It's, from what I understand, it's basically a movie that talks about the power of prayer and how prayer can make such a big difference in your life. So if you'd like to just come watch the movie and watch it with a group of people, we're going to do that next Sunday at 5:30. So I wanted to make sure you knew both of those. And one other thing, you notice a cross up here, if you notice that. We're going to add something different to the cross every week as we head to Easter. You probably can't see them, but today we added the 30 pieces of silver. That's a gold one. It'll be kind of silvery. But the 30 coins that Pontius Pilate was given to betray Jesus. So we added 30 coins to the cross, and next week we'll add something else that will get us to Easter. So I wanted to explain that to you. There's a silver one. So we're good. We're good.
There were hot pink and other colors.
We'll be okay. Our New Testament lesson today comes from the book of Romans, and this is Romans chapter 10, verses 8 to 13. But what does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is in your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As the scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And if you would please stand for the reading of our gospel lesson. Our gospel lesson is from the Gospel of Luke, and this is Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit to the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry.
The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone." So the devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answers, "It says, do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all his tempting, he left Jesus until an opportune time. You may be seated. Right before this part of scripture that I read, Jesus was baptized. And if you'll remember the baptism story, or if you haven't heard it, I'll just do a short synopsis. John the Baptist baptized Jesus. And after Jesus was baptized, the heavens opened up, and a spirit of the Lord descended upon Jesus like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." Jesus is the Son of God. In the gospel lesson this morning, we get a glimpse of what it means to be the Son of God. We see what Jesus rejected and what he accepted from the devil as the Son of God. Now, during this time of the wilderness, if you'll remember the reading, for 40 days he was tempted. Now, it doesn't matter what word you use, sin, temptation, devil, Satan, whatever word you use for that, Jesus was tempted. There are right choices in this life and there are bad choices, and we all know that sometimes the bad choices are cloaked so nicely that it's even hard to understand and separate good and bad. We find it so easy to rationalize our behavior because we conform it to the world's standards. Our first gospel lesson this morning, Luke tells us that Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. He left Jordan and entered the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. Nowhere does the scripture tell us that the Spirit ever left Jesus. When you and I are tempted, do we rely on the Holy Spirit, or do we tend to try and do a battle on our own? Sin comes to Jesus as a tempter. And to tell you the truth, he offers Jesus three things that really look pretty good. There doesn't seem to be anything horribly wrong with the things that he offers Jesus. He didn't tell him to kill anybody. He offered him bread and wealth and power. And we tend to think sometimes that's the American way. So sin doesn't always offer us bad things. We normally associate dark and murderous things. But sin is offering Jesus things that look pretty good. But let us look again at these temptations and how Jesus answers them. First of all, Jesus is fasting. He hasn't eaten for 40 days. He encounters the devil in the strength of 40 days of fasting. An author, Mark Buchanan, writes, "I have always thought that the devil was coming to Jesus at his weakest moment. Jesus was gaunt, raw-boned, wide-eyed, ready to scavenge any moldy crust of bread or scrape of meat. But I'm not so sure anymore," he writes. "The more I learn from fasting, the more I see that Jesus actually stood at his strongest when his belly was empty. Jesus is in a peak condition, a fighter who had been training hard. When he steps into the ring, the opponent doesn't have a chance." So that's one way Jesus helps send the devil packing. We, too, must stay alert at all times through the spiritual disciplines of God that God offers us. Prayer, fasting, worship, communion, Bible study, witnessing to our faith, that all keep us focused on God and allow the Holy Spirit in our decision making. So the devil says to him, as I said, if you are the Son of God, tell this rock to become bread. Well, Jesus says man does not live on bread alone. So why do you say that? I think sometimes that Jesus is reminding us that humans' urgent needs are not always physical. And the meeting of these physical needs was not necessarily Jesus' only mission. I'm sure Jesus was hungry. He was human, therefore, along with being divine. But he was full of the Holy Spirit. His experience of hunger was causing him to think of hungry people everywhere. Remember, Jesus didn't grow up in a temple. He didn't grow up in a castle. He grew up among the ordinary, and probably many of them were poor, and he knew the situation. He knew that there were people who didn't have enough to eat. He never forgot our nature and our needs. And that is why he would teach us to pray in the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. Jesus knew that nothing else in the world could get him quicker than following people of what they need. And suppose that he dedicated his power and leadership to producing food. We all know that Jesus could snap and we'd all have a banquet of food in front of us. Certainly that wouldn't be an evil thing. It might seem pretty good because we wouldn't have hunger in the world anymore. And it was good, but for Jesus, not the highest good. People would follow Jesus for loaves and fishes, and oftentimes then forget about the real gift of God, the true bread from heaven. The people needed bread for their souls rather than only bread for their bodies. How often are we tempted for us to do something that seems good, but not for the supreme good? Are we afraid to invite people to come to church because we're afraid that we'll offend them or lose our friendship with them or our popularity? Or is this one of the things that cause us not to share the gospel? Do we give in to the temptation not to offend when the most important thing is where a person will spend eternity? The second temptation was for Jesus to seek ambition, God's kingdom, through compromise. It is a subtle temptation to think that the ends justify the means. How often are we tempted to cut corners in order to achieve what we want? Or how often are we tempted to just step on somebody a little because it's not a lot? There's a right way and a wrong way to achieve our goals. And Jesus, the Son of God, chose the right way. He chose the cross. So foiled this far, the devil mimicked Jesus' use of scripture. So he says to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from this highest point. And then he quotes scripture, for it is written, he will command your angels to take care of you. And Jesus, I'm sure, laughed on the inside, simply looked at the devil and said, you know, it says, do not put the Lord your God to a test. Here, the temptation is to misuse scripture by twisting it to suit other purposes. The temptation was to be sensational, tempting Jesus to choose some other way than God's way. God's way was the way of the cross and of identifying with humankind of our trials and sufferings. Jesus came to be human and divine, to suffer right along with us. All of us are tempted to bypass God sometimes, or to choose another way. The way of the cross is difficult and hard, and yet is the only way to go. Jesus always chose the right way. And why did he do it? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. You see, love chooses the right way over the wrong way, even if right is hard. As Christians, we are always involved in the battles of the work of God, and therefore we must be full of the Holy Spirit first.
One theologian has noted, being committed to the way of God and the world does not exempt one from the struggle. In fact, it is often those who are most engaged in the way of God who seem to experience most intensely the opposition of evil. Jesus answers sins with very enticing temptations by quoting scripture. He doesn't use magic. He doesn't tell a parable or a miracle, or he doesn't rely on his own mental resistance. He doesn't just tell the devil, get out of here. He used and quoted scripture. We too need to understand and to read the scripture and know that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we will be able to overcome, which will lead to the great result of our lives. It will give us more peace, more power, a greater testimony, and a greater and more effective ministry. The Holy Spirit will not leave us during our time of temptations. I shared with you a few weeks ago one of my favorite verses, God is faithful and will not let you be tempted more than you can handle, but will help you find a way through it. Let us remember as we journey to the cross this Lent to make the right choice, to strive to be filled with the Holy Spirit and not let temptation win. Amen. If you will please stand, we're going to do a different creed today. It's number 883, the United Church of Canada Creed, and it is on the screen, or 883 in your hymn. Let us join together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. And our closing hymn is Happy the Home When God Is There. It's number 445, or it'll be on the screen. Eternal life. Amen. Let us join and go now in peace.